All right, let's jump into it, guys. So as the title says, okay, I just finished writing my 10th short story slash poem, okay, which marks a major milestone in my writing journey. Now I can officially call myself a poet, okay? Oh man, it's been quite a journey. It's been 7 months, writing these short stories. Okay, I started this little side project in December of 2023. And I was inspired by my good friend Lewis, who was trying to do a freestyle rap every day or every week, I think. I'm not too sure what the project was, right? But when I saw him consistently put out freestyle raps every now and then, I was like, you know what? I can do that. Not realizing it's actually really hard to write, actually to like sit down and like write your thoughts and write your ideas out, okay? Because not only do you have like the blocks of just like your imagination, but also like life happening all around you, okay? But I made a commitment to myself to be as consistent as possible with writing these short stories, right? And I did, right? 10 is a huge milestone, okay? A lot of people start projects, but they don't follow through, okay? And one of the main reasons why, you know, other than challenging myself to, you know, be consistent in my writing, one of the main reasons why I wanted to dive into writing short stories and poems is because I wanted to keep my writing pen sharp, okay? When I'm not writing my scripts, I get creative blocks. When I'm not writing my scripts, I still want to be able to, you know, practice writing, right? It's like a muscle, right? You go to the gym to work out, to, you know, keep training, keep your body healthy. The same thing applies to art as well, okay? If you're not working out your main muscle, okay, you gotta do interval workouts, right? To keep your body warm in a sense, okay? And I wanted to keep my writing warm, so I decided to, you know, get into writing short stories and poems, okay? Another aspect of writing short stories and poems is that I wanted to really explore my imagination, explore my writing, okay? And also for me to process the world around me and the emotions that I'm experiencing. And writing was definitely one of the main ways to do that outside of music. Also too, another reason as well, I wanted to get into the writing short stories and poems because I wanted to learn to be a little bit more empathetic to people and their experiences, all right? A lot of my short stories are based on other people as well, okay? And I wanted to be able to see the point of view of other people and how they're experiencing their lives. And I want to put myself in their shoes. Because naturally, I'm not an empathetic person. Like, I generally don't care for anyone else's feelings. I know that sounds bad, but I just don't. I have sort of a one-track mind where it's just like mission objective. And I get tunnel vision to the point where I don't care about how anyone else feels. And things like, you know, it's funny, I'm saying this right now, but I assure you, the vast majority of people in America feel the same exact way. The vast majority of people in America do not care about people's feelings. America is a very meritocracy based society where it's facts over feelings, okay? And that's kind of how I operate, and that's kind of how I've trained myself. But I don't want to lose myself in that sort of mentality and become a drone in a gear in the American work system. So writing allows me to, you know, pull back that aspect of myself so I can be a little bit more conscientious to other people's feelings, okay? So lastly, another reason why I started writing short stories is because I wanted to keep telling stories. There are so many things that are happening all around me in my life that I feel like could be transcribed and translated into stories that I just didn't want to like hold on to, okay? Like hold on to for like a bigger project, because, you know, there's so many ideas that happen to me. There's so many ideas and things that happen in life that I'm just like, man, that'll make a great film. But the thing is, like, writing scripts, writing films, and trying to get those films done takes quite a bit of time out of your life, like a lot. Like the main script that I'm working on right now, it's taking me 2 years because of just life happening all around me, and to find the time and the dedication to like write this project, it takes a lot out of you. But the thing is, it's like, the saying in writing that says, don't waste your pain, okay? And write what you know. And so I had to train my mind to like see things and hear things and see different aspects of happen. So I had to like really train my observational mind to pick up on things that I can take from and create stories from, okay? So I have like a whole list of short story ideas that I can build upon. Okay, so let me let you into like how my mind works, right? Like I could hear a conversation and then from that conversation see a whole story, right? I can see something on the news and, you know, hear someone talking about something on the news and then from there build a whole story from it. Or I can be watching a film and there's like one little minor aspect of a character's story or a minor character story that I would see. I'm like, yo, that little aspect right there will actually make a great story. So write it down, right? Same thing too. Whenever I meet people, you know, men and women, and I hear about what they're going through, I sort of imagine what their backstory was and I can write from that as well, you know? So that's just how my mind works. And that's why I have to like train my mind to take everything and to create stories from them. So, you know, the 7-month journey of, you know, writing these 10 short stories and poems, each of these stories really, truly represents an aspect of my life and my journey. And, you know, when I go back and I read what I wrote or I listen to what I wrote, you know, it's very cathartic and it's just a different experience that I can't really explain, because it's like when I hear myself speak these stories that I've written, I'm at awe with the fact that I wrote these stories, because they're just so, they're just so prolific, if that's the right word. I know the saying goes, you know, don't exalt yourself, and, you know, don't give yourself praise, but, you know, I take immense pride with how far I've come with my writing. Like, it's incredible to see where I started all the way back in fourth grade writing little children's stories to now. It's beautiful for me. And if anything, like, I write for me, okay? And I write to experience myself, to get to know myself better, okay? I could give two craps about what anyone thinks about my writing. I generally don't care. I know that everything that I create, everything that I produce is authentic to me, and I love it and I enjoy it. I don't care what the world thinks. This is a God-given gift that God has given me, and I'm not going to waste it. And I'm not going to worry about other people's opinions when it comes to the art that I create, because it has nothing to do with them and everything to do with me and God. Plain and simple. Now, when you hear that, you might be thinking like, oh my God, Phazon, you're being a little bit arrogant. You're being a little bit prideful. I'm humbled in the sense that God has given me this gift, okay? That's where I'm humble at, right? All glory to God when it comes to his gift of writing, the gift of the word that he's given me, right? But when it comes to the world, it means nothing to me, because I don't make things for the world. I don't. I make art to honor God, and I make art to understand myself. Plain and simple. What the world thinks of the stuff that I produce means absolutely nothing to me. Nothing at all. All glory to him. Plain and simple. And I know God is pleased that I'm not wasting this gift of writing that he's giving me. I know he's pleased, okay? I know he's pleased. And I know for a fact when it comes to writing, you know, the work, it will blow up in his own time, right? But it's a matter of me being consistent with putting out these stories, right? And if it blows up, great. If it doesn't blow up, I don't give a damn. I don't. I'm enjoying the process, and the process is the most important thing. Now, you know, I told a female friend of mine, you know, I finally revealed to her that, like, you know, when she had asked me, like, oh, so Phazon, like, what is it that you do? And I told her, like, oh, I'm a writer. And she was like, oh, that's so nice. You know, you're getting in touch with your feminine side. You know, because y'all was so rigid and so closed up. And when I heard that, I was thinking to myself, like, what? Feminine side? Like, what? Writing is feminine? Writing is feminine? You know, I had to, like, think about that. And I was like, yo, you know, most of the most famous, most prolific, most influential writers have been men. Well, I mean, like, how is that feminine? You know what I'm saying? Creativity is inherently a masculine thing, you know? Create, because you're creating a world, you're creating an ecosystem with every word that you create, that you put on paper, that you decide to put out there in the world. Like, putting yourself out there in the world and exposing yourself on that very vulnerable and emotional level, that is inherently a masculine trait, right? If you try to close yourself off too much from the world, I feel like you're hiding yourself. and hiding yourself is cowardice. And that, in a sense, is more feminine than anything else. Okay. So I took a step back to try to understand what she was trying to say. And I think what she really meant was that, you know, writers are sensitive, and sensitive is could be attributed to being emotional, right? And emotional is a feminine trait, and that in itself is considered weak, okay? Being a feminine type of man, right? And so I got that side of it, right? But I didn't really read into it too much though, because like I said, the opinions of other people don't really mean anything to me. But the things like this, yes, writers are sensitive. We have to be sensitive. We process the world on such a high level that it's overwhelming, okay? And sometimes, and that's the reason why we have to be away and go away and be in quiet places and be closed off to the world so that we can process what's going on in our mind, because a writer's mind is always running nonstop, 24/7, never stops. So the performance aspect of my short stories and poems, right? So all my short stories are narrated and performed by myself, okay? And the reason why I did that is because all these stories are emotional. Like reading them is, you know, one thing, and you can gauge the emotions from the words that I chose in these short stories. But to fully experience my short stories, you have to hear the emotions in the words that I speak, right? Because the words that I speak create the visuals of what I was going through in those specific moments in time, okay? And I found a way to translate those specific moments in time into words. And it's important for me, for you, to feel exactly what I was trying to convey based on what I was experiencing in those moments in time, right? Hope that made sense. So, my most meaningful and my most emotional stories, I will say the first one would be As I Lie Awake. I wrote that back when I was in that old apartment that caused me so much stress and so much strife. And that place got in the way of my writing in ways that you could never understood as a writer, as a creative. Like, you don't understand, like as a writer, you need absolute quiet so you can focus on the words that are trying to come out of you. And I couldn't because of where I was living, bro. It was so noisy, and I was living under a bum who didn't do anything with his life but be a bum and cause stress and disturbance for me, someone who's trying to contribute to the world. And so those powerful emotions, okay, I had to put into As I Lie Awake. Okay, not only that, As I Lie Awake, there was no break. Like in the world of As I Lie Awake, there was no break. It was constant stress, man. Stress at work, stress at home, stress in my personal relationships, and I never got a break. And then on top of that too, I had to figure out a way to write this film that I was trying to get done under this immense amount of stress and strife, dude. And As I Lie Awake was just the culmination of those emotions. And when you listen to As I Lie Awake, like I didn't hold back, man. I went full on, right? And things like, you know, As I Lie Awake is one of the few short stories where I curse, because I don't like cursing in my personal work, you know, that are outside of, you know, screenplay writing and characters, right? When it comes to like personal things like me that I put out there, I try my best not to curse too much though, because like that's not the image that I want to convey to the world, okay? But the thing is, like, you had to feel exactly what I was feeling in As I Lie Awake, okay? Now, after As I Lie Awake is Bella's Cut. And Bella's Cut is a culmination of two experiences, I mean, that happened to me that I combined into one, okay? And Bella's Cut is just, the best way I can explain it, it's the flaw in my character of being too open with romantic interests and being too vulnerable with romantic interests to the point where those vulnerabilities get used against me. You know, as men, you know, we desire safety as well. You know, we desire the safety as well when it comes to the emotions that we deal with, okay? Because I don't think people, like, there's one thing people want to, like, neglect when it comes to men, but, you know, we're human beings too. We have feelings as well. And men, we have the same emotional capacity as women do, right? But the thing is, like, our minds work differently to the point where we can shut off our emotions because it's illogical to act upon emotions, because it is a survival mechanism that, you know, if you become too emotional, you can be exploited, and that exploitation can lead to your demise, okay? And so as men, we, once we find someone, especially a woman, that kind of, you know, that we believe sees us, we let our guard down. We let our guard down and we start, you know, sharing personal things with the woman that we think that we can trust, you know, while ignoring the red flags of the woman that we are involved with. And that in itself, it's like being too vulnerable with the wrong woman is like you're giving the knife to her to stab you in the back, okay? And that's what Bella's cut represents, Bella's cut. Because I really thought, you know, I really thought that this girl and I, we had something, you know, but I couldn't see the red, I ignored the red flags of her drinking and her bad habits. And it cost me, you know, it cost me, and it hurt really bad. And, you know, after that incident with, you know, that the story was based on, yeah, I sort of closed up and shut down a bit. And I'm very careful now with who and what I reveal to certain people, but especially women. And it's sad, you know, it is really sad. And, you know, and I get this a lot from a lot of women, like, oh, you know, open up more, you're so rigid, blah, 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 blah. And I was just like, you know, there's a reason why, and I don't need to explain myself. I don't need to explain myself to, you know, women when it comes to why, you know, I'm closed off about a lot of things. Because at the end of the day, you know, I think women tend to not understand that it takes time for a man to open up, and it takes time for a man to trust you, right? We do certain things and we lay certain tests to see whether or not we can trust you. Just like you want that same trust from us, we require that same trust too, okay? But we're not gonna just lay our hearts out to you just like that. We're not gonna wear our hearts on the sleeve just like that. Like a true mature man is not gonna do that. A true mature man's gonna be able to see things and observe things and test the waters before he jumps in and swims, okay? Because, you know, if the waters are a little bit too rocky and too turbulent, right? And, you'll drown, and it'll cost you more than you ever believe. And then, okay, so that leads me into the next one. All right, it's funny, I'm talking about jumping into the wrong waters, you know, when it comes to revealing yourself to people. All right, the next one is depths of a guarded heart, and that one was based off of a deeply emotional episode that I went through that was kind of public, you know. And depths of a guarded heart, you know, when I wrote that, like, I wrote that, like, on the fly, like, you know, during a break in my job, and I just had to get that story out of me, and I had to figure out a way to process that, because there are so many things that I was going through, and so many things that I was experiencing on an emotional level with that, and, you know, certain people saw a side of me that I regret showing, you know, and the fear and the shame and the guilt that came over me when they saw that side of me was something that I truly couldn't articulate in myself. So I had to write it down and put it into the format of a poetry to truly understand what it was. And, you know, this is, you know, this is the thing about emotions, because even me myself, I'm still learning how to deal with my emotions, right? And that's the reason why I write. Writing truly allows me to understand and explore my emotions, because they're deep. They're deep, and they're very deep, you know, and they're exactly the things, like, there is truly no words for me to describe what my emotions are, but in order for me to keep them controlled and keep them composed, writing, art, and then music as well, allows me to truly process what I was going through. And Depths of a Guarded Heart was definitely one of the most emotional pieces of writing that I've ever done. Now, the last piece of writing that I really enjoyed doing was Dear Cara. And Dear Cara, that one was based on a conversation that I had with a coworker, and also is based on a conversation that I had with many women. And a lot of the issues that women tend to blame men for stems from having absent fathers, or fathers who just didn't measure up to the ideal of what a man is. And so Dear Cara is a short story, but it's also a letter written from the dad's perspective of trying his best to rekindle a relationship that he ruined with his daughter. And that story, like, it's, how can I explain it? Like, that story is, there's layers to it, okay? There's layers to that story, because, like, that story and that letter that I wrote, right? Like, that story represents the conversation that many girls and many young women want to have with their fathers, that they felt that their fathers betrayed them and wasn't there for them on an emotional level, that they want to have, that they should have, but unfortunately they will never have, or they can't have, for whatever reason. The other aspect of why I wrote it was because I wanted to put myself in the shoes that I don't want to be in by writing this letter, right? If that makes sense. So, like, I wrote this letter so that I wouldn't have to write this letter, because by the time I have a daughter, I should be fully aware and I should fully understand how women are, okay? And the thing is, like, you know, as when you listen to the story, women are, they're humans, okay? Like anyone else, and they make mistakes, you know? And as men, you know, this is a natural thing. We tend to hold women to this high esteem of just being pure and righteous and whatnot, but not realizing that, you know, women are very chaotic. They do a lot of things that just don't make any sense, okay? And as a man, you know, especially as a father, whenever you see your daughter going astray, because that's what, you know, Dear Cara, that's one of the essences of Dear Cara. Whenever you see your daughter going astray, you have a choice of being comforting, reassuring, and, you know, being in a position to teach your daughter to be better, or you could chastise your daughter in a way that it pushes them away, right? And the father in Dear Cara chastises his daughter to an extent where he pushes her away. And that's not what I want for myself as a father when it comes to the child that I bring into this world. You know, children are going to make mistakes. And as a parent, your love should be unconditional, okay? It's a very sad story because it ends in a way where there may not even be a resolution for both parties, you know? The damage was done. And, you know, women, when it comes to certain things, they experience things on such a heightened emotional level that it could be very unbearable for them to cope with a loved one hurting them in a way. And I wrote that letter so I wouldn't have to write that letter, okay? I wrote that letter so that I understand what not to do, okay? That's the other layer of Dear Cara, okay? Anyway, you know, close out this video. I want to say this one thing, okay? Because all my short stories are very emotional, and they're told through a male's perspective, right? There's probably going to be some down the road that I write through a female's perspective. My first film was written through a female's perspective. Here's the thing, though. You know, I am very against men showing their emotions in a public type of setting. I'm against that, you know, because it will be used against you. It is what it is, right? There's a truth to that. Like, if you're lucky enough to find someone, man or woman, that you can trust with your emotions, you know, that is God's gift to you. Like I said before, you know, men also require That safety net when it comes to people understanding their emotions. And, you know, it takes time for a man to open up in the regards to their emotions, because it hurts when someone backstabs you by using your vulnerabilities against you, because they know that they can't hurt you physically, they hurt you emotionally. And it's painful, you know, because trust is one of the most important things that we give each other. And when that trust is betrayed, you know, it's unsettling and it's eye-opening. And it is just a reminder of the flaw in human nature. And it also kind of reminds you to still at the same time forgive, but also to be aware of who you're dealing with so you don't make that mistake twice when it comes to the next person coming into their lives. You know, it is what it is. You know, and this is where the rigidity of who I am comes into play, because I'm very fluid and expressive in my work and in my art, but in my personal front-facing persona, you can kind of say, if I don't know you, you know, if I don't know certain things about you, then I'm not going to tell certain things about me. You know, trusting, you can trust me with your secrets and your emotions, and I expect you to trust me the same way too with my emotions as well. And, you know, when I put my emotions in the medium of writing and art and music, right, I am putting those out there for the world and for everyone else to hear and to see, in a means of not having to have those conversations with certain people, because the work is already done. You know, if people truly want to understand me, Phazon, experience my work, experience my art. You know, there is, you know, until I get into a more serious relationship, which then in itself is going to be its own journey of, you know, exploring. There is no reason for me to divulge certain aspects of myself to anyone. Why? I just put it in writing, I put it in music, I put it out there, and let the world, let the public connect with it, you know? And in hopes that these stories allow people to understand that they're not alone in what they're experiencing. And, you know, and in a way help them to process what they're going through as well, and to show them that there's other people are experiencing what they're experiencing. They themselves should not be scared to express their emotions in an artistic setting. Okay, that's just my prerogative, right? I believe that men, especially men, should find a creative outlet to express their emotions, and not let it build up to a point where it becomes violent and volatile. Because, like I said, once people see who you are on an emotional level, like, sure, they may forgive you in that moment, right? But in their human mind, they're gonna remember, this is who you are, that you are an emotional, you are someone who doesn't have self-control. And self-control shows that this person is not safe, okay? That's the truth right there, okay? Anyway, guys, that's the end of this upload, this video. All right. Next video, I'm talking about my prayers that I wrote. Okay. But until then, be well, be safe. May God be with you. God bless you. Praise be to God, because there's none greater. Take it easy, guys. Deuces.